I invite Arik Bahar, George Galloway, Hushan Amirahmadi, Mikhail Khazin, Ashok Jazayan, Mohammed Salmawi.
Good evening.
Salam alaikum.
I don't see my name.
Your name?
Your name is one.
No, just a moment. I think it's last.
Just a address
and name.
A name tag, yes. Let's see if I can get that. I'll try and find out. Okay. One missing.
Дорогі друзья, начинаем работу.
Dear friends, let us start the work.
Please take your translates.
You also want to do it?
Okay, no problem. Мы начинаем четвертое заседание.
Start
10-го евразийского медиафорума.
Of the 10th Eurasian Media Forum.
У нас еще не хватает Ашота Джазаяна.
We
Если кто его увидит, то скажите, что его
ждут. If you see him somewhere, please let him know that we are waiting for him. The double standard, the media's double standard, from color revolutions to the Syrian civil war.
Я представляю участников дискуссии. Меня зовут Максим Шевченко. Я ведущий программы в контексте Первого канала российского телевидения, член Совета по межнациональным отношениям при президенте Российской Федерации. Сегодняшние спикеры.
Джордж Гэллоуэй,
член парламента Великобритании, известнейших журналистов, общественных деятелей нашего времени.
Джордж
известен своей позицией по Ближнему Востоку, по Палестине.
Арик
Бахар, генеральный секретарь Израильского совета по делам прессы. Хушан Амирахмади, президент Американо-Иранского совета. Михаил Хазин, президент компании экспертного консультирования «Неокон», Россия. Мухаммед Сальмауи, главный редактор газеты «Аль-Ахрам Хебдо», Египет. И к нам присоединится, уверен, по ходу нашего разговора Ашот Джазаян, заявленный в дискуссии генеральный секретарь Международной конфедерации журналистских союзов из России. В чем актуальность этой темы? Для меня она актуальность прежде всего в самом названии. Мне до конца непонятно, что такое двойные стандарты СМИ. Где грань для журналистики сегодня между погоней за жареным фактом, за поднятием рейтинга, за развитием бизнеса, за трансляцией такого образа событий, который является продаваемым, и следованием правде? Правде, которая может быть неприятна зрителю, непонятна зрителю, а может быть неприятна и непонятна еще и властям, на территории которых действует современное средство массовой информации. Информационное общество, которое охватывает всю территорию земного шара, вынуждает СМИ к серьезным информационным сражениям, буквально к битвам за образ того или иного события. Мы теперь легко говорим о Сирии, о Ливии. И мы видим, что есть, по крайней мере, две непримиримые точки зрения, которые борются за право постулировать истину, что вот события в Ливии именно такие, какие, допустим, из точки зрения Запада, Каддафи плохой, оппозиция хорошая. Нет,
Каддафи
есть иная точка зрения на события в Ливии. Каддафи приносил пользу своему народу, оппозиция является американской агентурой. И могу сказать вам, что эти точки зрения вполне конкурируют в медийном пространстве. Буквально создались два медийных пространства.
Media
одно, в котором только одна точка зрения, к сожалению, пространство Запада, на мой взгляд, оно в основном с единственной точки зрения. Вот в России, например, мы можем говорить о том, что Каддафи плохой, Каддафи хороший. Честно скажу, в западных медиаресурсах я такого не встречал. Но давайте мы перейдем к нашей дискуссии, и у меня первый вопрос к Джорджу Галлоуэй. Скажите, Джордж, вот как, каким образом в современном мире добиться от современных медиа объективного представления картины реальности? Или современные медиа уже заведомо ангажированы вследствие своей зависимости от финансов, от бизнеса, от
already
и так далее,
not possible for that because they are concerned with their ratings, the sales of their magazines.
The proliferation of media, the plurality of media, can we arrive at the truth? As long as information is fed through the prism of either billionaire individual owners or, in the case of the Bush and Blair Corporation, formerly known as the BBC, which passes through the prism of the prevailing orthodoxy of British and American policy, or through the prism of Al Jazeera, for example, where the royal family will soon be reading the news as well as leading the news, where the journalists are being forced to commit journalistic suicide in the interests of the foreign policy of a tiny state the size of a large petrol station. All the information that comes through these kind of prisms has to be treated with the proverbial pinch of salt or bucket of salt. But if we have, to use the Chinese phrase, 1,000 flowers blooming on the internet, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and the huge proliferation of television and radio stations that the digital age has now made possible, somehow we'll arrive at the truth. And there's a democratic question here, because people are buying fewer and fewer newspapers owned by the traditional newspaper owners. They're watching less and less television provided by the traditional providers. And they are searching everywhere on the internet for information. And that's democratic. And I believe it's a gigantic step forward for journalism. The great communist Irish journalist Claude Coburn said that the proper relationship between the journalist and the state should be like the dog to the lamppost, and that nothing is true until it has been officially denied. That's what we need to demand from our journalists. It's what we don't get from 99% of our journalists, but I believe that in the future we will more and more.
А вот вы знаете, Джордж?
You know what, George?
Вопрос просто кратко на него ответьте,
could you please give a short answer that I was always worried with? When the communists are in opposition, they support free press, and leftist newspapers are most independent. But as soon as they come to power, all of the opposition newspapers are destroyed and closed down. We know that very well in the former Soviet Union, and everything turns into one-color ideological space. What is the paradox here?
It's the paradox of dictatorship. In a dictatorship, whether it's a communist one or a fascistic one or any other kind of dictatorship, the line of the party or the leadership becomes the prevailing orthodoxy and becomes, moreover, deadly dull. And anyone who was looking for the truth wouldn't have looked in Pravda, which means truth. That would have been the last place you'd find Pravda. Would have been in Pravda. So it's a paradox that the left people like me have to live with. I all the time knew it, but others did not. That if we ever come to power again, then we have to live with a plural media market. I, my wife and I have just arrived from Venezuela this morning, where 95% of the media market is controlled by the private sector, virulently hostile to President Hugo Chavez, but he has just won another magnificent victory. So it is possible for the truth to be out.
Спасибо. Господин Бахар,
Mr. Bahar, thank you,
Израиль,
George. Mr. Bahar, you represent Israel that for many years in a row has been fighting the information wars. Unfortunately, the Israeli state in the Middle East is circled, is in the fire line of real and information wars at the same time. For Israel, that has to continuously prove something to everybody, what are the media's double standards, and do you see, do you recognize such double standards in media?
Well, one of the recent developments in the Israeli media industry, which is undergoing the kind of difficulties the print media especially is undergoing all over the Western world and beyond, is that there's too much concentration in the hands of too few publishers. We have recently, one paper was established that's very quickly become the number one in terms of readership, and that is totally committed to Prime Minister Netanyahu, his government, and his policies. But obviously there are other titles which carry different editorial lines. And I think, as George was saying, plurality is the crucial element here. It doesn't matter whether a particular paper is too committed to a certain ideological line. So although papers in the perfect world should not be committed to such lines. But so long as we have diversity, and we do, then you have a lot of criticism of government policies ranging in issues from the Palestinian conflict to settlements to the Iranian issue and any other social issues. But you are right in the sense that Israel's media has had to evolve in a way that few other media industries around the world have. In other words, you try to invent yourself every day while you are struggling with real conflicts. I mean, the propaganda wars are an important element, but the real wars are the ones fought on the ground, and they can cause bloodshed. So I think despite the fact that Israel has quite a few laws and regulations, some of them dating back to British Mandate times before Israel was created, quite a number of laws in terms of military censorship, defamation laws, and so on, the media has managed to retain a vibrancy that has really improved lives and increased the health of the political system. I mean, it's thanks to media reporting that we have a former president currently in jail, serving time for sexual offenses. We've just had a former prime minister convicted of corruption charges, and we've had quite a few lists where, but a finance secretary who's doing 5 years at the moment for corruption. So the media there has survived this various attempts by governments to stifle independent voices. And but we at the Press Council, one of our primary concerns, apart from ethics in the media, such as the Press Complaints Commission in the UK, is we lobby against restrictive rules which right-wing, especially, trying to push through our parliament. And we've been quite successful at that.
I will ask a clarifying question, because what you are saying right now is extremely important. After the two interventions that we've just heard, we can come to the conclusion that, in fact, journalism is called free only conditionally. It is applied, and it's an instrument in the hands of elites and establishment that works on various global projects. From that perspective, Mr. Mirahmadi, crazy.
Вы возглавляете американо-иранский совет в современной ситуации. Это звучит несколько парадоксально.
Когда такой совет like существует,
и он действует.
Does exist,
скажите, каким образом,
does work.
Вот, я когда был в Тегеране, мы
when
ходили на
Tehran,
TV,
visited,
это англоязычный
иранский
канал, который дает совсем иную картину
Iranian
событий в мире. Вот вы, наверное, бываете, вы смотрите и пресс ТВ,
sure
и смотрите и американские телеканалы на
TV channels, and you know how different the points of view on Syrian conflict is. What presentation is more adequate to you? How do you manage in making decisions, in analyzing the situation and information that you get from Press TV and CNN? How do you manipulate that and how you use that in decision making?
Thank you. I think it's important that the listener, the reader, has to be very intelligent. Obviously, the world is too complex, and issues are very complicated, and I think the reader and the listener must indeed be educated. The biggest problem we have is that most of the listener and readers are not educated, and the media abuses that lack of education on the part of the general public. First, I have to say that the problem with the media is not just it's under control of government. The problem with the media is that it really suppresses itself. The media, indeed, is self-suppressive, and the media also, I believe, uses language, techniques, and code of ethics that are not proper. Again, I'm not going to generalize. There are good media. There are good people still in the media. There are incredibly good, credible people with integrity. But broadly speaking, the media today, being Press TV or New York Times or Washington Post, they are biased. On both sides, they really are biased. Press TV is as biased as CNN or Fox or others. There is no such a thing as a good reporting from Press TV. It's just not there. Or for the other one. The fact is that the media increasingly using what I call double speak. And the double speak is a concept in the media that says it distorts, it disinforms, it reverses the meaning of words. It's not just euphemism, it's more than that, not the intentional vagueness that is also a part of that enterprise. In fact, the media was supposed to be, either Press TV or CNN or whatever, they are supposed to follow what I call a standard code of conduct. The standard code, you have to be truthful, accurate, you have to be well-informed, you have to present the facts as they are, you cannot construct facts, and you have to let the reader, the listener, to decide what is happening, as opposed to you editorializing the news or whatever for them. But that's not happening, unfortunately. It's not happening. When it comes to my term, I could give you examples of the problem between US and Iran, particularly in the nuclear issue, to show how difficult it is to understand. And it's that both sides say things that are on the surface of it is true, but when you dig into it, it is not. That there are both sides are lying. The both sides are not saying the truth, and so again, I think also it's not just a matter of double standard. I think the double standard is a very simplified term. I mean, think of President Obama and Mitt Romney. The way they represent each other, or the media in the Republican or the Democratic side, they really misrepresent a lot of positions that each side take. And they have a double standard right there. It's not just a double standard between East and the West, between Muslims and Christians. It within this ideological frameworks, within the democracies, for example, between Mr. Bush and Mr. Romney, or Mr. Romney and Obama. So again, what I'm saying is that, so I think the media suffers from a much deeper problem, a problem of ethic, a problem of double speak, a problem of being dishonest, you know, lack of accuracy, information, and obviously media is not, you know, without any basis in terms of like interest or ideology. The fact is that they are very much contaminated with the ideologies that are around and with the interest that stand behind them. So that's the issue. And when it comes to my term, I will talk about U.S.-Iran relations later on.
Михаил Хазин.
Михаил Хазин.
Михаил Леонидович, ну вот Михаил смотрите, Леонидович. Получается, что
Look,
из нашего разговора, что есть СМИ для думающих людей, то есть думающий человек, в принципе, есть СМИ для массы людей, да, которые у нас объявляются недумающими. Значит, СМИ для массы людей, ему как бы можно быть просто интересным.
Non-thinking mass media could be just interesting, while the mass media for intelligent people and thinking people should be intellectual and intelligent. Maybe there is no freedom of speech at all. This is just a tool and information weapon.